All right, let's get into our second talk of the day. Our next speaker is Dr. Suyang Zhu from Harvard University, and he's going to talk to us about the topological response in bile and Dirac semimetals.
All right, thank you for the invitation. So I'm Suyang. I'm from the Department of Chemistry and Chemical Biology. I'm an experimentalist working on quantum materials, broadly speaking. So I'm going to talk about a task by the organizers about Dirac and vial, which is, you know, sort of overlap with what Anton talks about, but hopefully it's from a completely different perspective. So so this is kind of an outline for both this talk and the next one tomorrow. So I'm going to first talk about basically, you know, topology and geometry in quantum materials. And then we are going to talk about Dirac and vial submetals and their experimental discoveries. And then we'll talk a little bit about their electromagnetic responses. Okay, so topology. So probably you guys have seen this slide many, many times if you work on similar field. So basically, we know topology in real space, you know, classifies different shapes. For instance, here we have the number of holes, which somehow is the most popular example, and then we have the Gauss-Bonnet theorem, where you can compute the local curvature of this shape, and once you integrate, you get you know, an integer number which is related to the number of holes of the shape. And then this, I guess the reason that it was very widely used is has a very similar analog to what we actually study in condensed matter, where we have this curvature that is called the Barrett curvature, which in most textbooks, they didn't really tell you what is the curvature about, where is the curvature. But anyway, there's a curvature. You know, here you can see there's a curvature of the surface, but then here you don't see any curvature. But there's a curvature, and you integrate the curvature, you get the Chern number. And the Chern number is related to, you know, the topological invariant. Okay, so just one slide. I guess everybody knows this. But then what I want to do here is try to provide some more intuition, because I'm an experimentalist. Also, I work in the Department of Chemistry. So let's see if we can see where is the curvature, you know, from orbitals, atoms in my unit cell, how the electron moves, how the orbital runs. And hopefully that builds you a better intuition for future studies, okay? So that's what I mean by we're going to talk about topology and geometry, okay? So we're going to start from 1D band. We can basically think about, let's say, I have a lattice of hydrogen atom, which is 1s orbital. Then obviously I get a band, energy as a function of wave vector k. Okay, so how do we visualize this from chemistry point of view? So we can think about this as a giant molecule, right? So if I just connect the left hand to the right, then I have a giant ring. The ring has basically infinite number of equally spaced hydrogen atoms, and then I'm trying to solve for the energy eigenstate of this molecule, right? So then basically I can think about a building from simpler molecules. Let's say I just have H2, right? Then, you know, if we have H2, then because we have two orbitals, then we have two energy levels, and these, you know, are quite obvious. We have a bounding orbital, which, you know, they interfere, they have the same phase, so they interfere constructively, that have a lower energy, and then we have an antibonding orbital where they have opposite phase. Okay, so they're both s orbitals, so that's it. So then, you know, from this, then we can insert more more atoms. For instance, then we can think about three atoms. Then we have this triangular molecule, right? Then you see that you have three energy levels. The lowest energy is always the ground state, okay? But then I have two excited states that are degenerate, and then I have four. Then I have one, two, one, okay? And then you can think about how the orbital runs, how the phase change as I go from one one atom to the next one. You know, the bonding orbital is always the same phase; so it doesn't really change. And then then the only kind of constraint that I need to impose is that, you know, this changes by certain amount, but then as I go, all the way back to the same atom, my phase has to either doesn't change, which is this case, or change by the amount of 2 pi, or 2 pi modular integer, multiplies integer, right? So in this case, then you can show that essentially your phase changes by e to the I 2 pi over 3, because if you jump 3 times, then you get e to the I 2 pi. Again, right? So in this case, then you can show that you phase jump by e to the I 2 pi over 4 or pi over 2. Then if you jump 4 times, you get 2 pi. And here you jump by e to the I pi. Then if you jump twice, you get back to yourself. You jump again twice, you get back to yourself again. So this is, you can see that here the highest one is the antibonding orbital again, right? So then you can basically follow this logic, just insert more and more atoms to your molecule, then essentially you can already see the trend, because my lowest energy state is always the bonding state, and then my highest energy state is always the antibonding. Antibonding means that as I go from one to the next one, the phase jumps by pi, or in other words, it goes to the opposite sign. Okay, so that's antibonding. And then, you know, in between, I have many doubly degenerate states. And then the lower that I go, that means that, you know, the phase basically start to modulate, but still modulate slowly in real space, okay? And then as I go to the higher parts, then the phase modulate faster with a shorter wavelength. And the shortest or the fastest I can oscillate is basically as I go to the next one, I get the minus sign. That's the antibond, okay? And then you see that I always have two states, and that's basically, you know, in your band structure. So this guy would be my bonding, this guy would be my antibonding, and then, you know, if I cut anywhere between the top and the bottom here, I have two states, because the phase can either go clockwise or counterclockwise. In other words, it can propagate to the left or propagate to the right, okay? So that's kind of a chemical point of view of a band. Okay, stop me if there's any question. So you know, then using this, we can actually, you know, think about either, you know, I build a band from s orbital. I could also build a band from p orbital. You will immediately see that if I do the same thing for the p orbital, right? So here, I have the bonding. Okay, so everywhere I have a p orbital, and they have the same sign, so they just repeat. And then for k equals to pi, then basically every time I have a p orbital, I flip the sign. But then because of the internal structure of the p orbital, now you see that this actually, it's actually opposite. It's actually an antibond, right? Here it's actually bonding because of the p itself internally also is an odd orbital, right? So then you can see that actually the band, is facing down instead of facing up, okay? So that would be basically tight binding from chemistry point of view. You can show that, you know, s orbital is facing up, p orbital band is facing down, okay? So why am I talking about this? Well, okay, so how do we visualize, geometry or topology, right? So basically what I'm trying to show you or trying to argue is basically then, we know that this topology and geometry exist. We're describing the Bloch wave function, right? So then, when we think about the Bloch wave function, they are actually, what I have described to you so far is basically the wave vector. And the wave vector basically you know, here I'm not drawing any internal atoms or orbitals. I'm just drawing a unit cell, okay? So every parallelogram, this is now a 2D lattice, every parallelogram is a unit cell. So basically this, this K tells me essentially how does my wave function, the phase of my wave function change as I go from one unit cell to the next one, right? For instance, we talk about K equals to zero. Now in two dimension, that would be, you know, I have a two dimensional Brillouin zone. Yeah, and then basically I have two coordinates for K. So let's say I really sit at the gamma point, which is you know, K equals to zero for both X and Y. Then basically that means that, you know, if this is, you know, a single unit cell, and the, you know, and then basically as I go to the next one, the phase of my Bloch wave is the same. As I go to the next one, the phase of my Bloch wave is the same, right? So it's basically the same as what I told you before, just in two dimensions, right? So now if I try to visualize, for instance, K equals to X, pi and zero, then basically, you know, imagine this yellow and orange is positive and negative sign. Then basically what I'm showing here is as I go from one unit cell to the next one, the phase changes along the X direction, along the KX direction, then the, along the X direction, the real space. Then the phase flips. And then flips again along the X direction, just like what I showed you before. But then if I go along the Y here, X and Y are kind of not Cartesian. But if I go to the, along the Y direction, then the phase is it doesn't really change because KY now is zero, okay? So you can use this logic to basically visualize also zero pi, then, you know, it modulates along the Y direction, but doesn't change along the X direction. And then finally you have pi, then, you know, then it modulates along both X and Y direction. Okay? So so basically I want to talk about band, and I want to talk about, you know, the wave vector. Okay? So then why am I talking about this? Well, because when we talk about this, we still, you know, neglect another important point of view. That is, you know, we have always been just talking about how the wave function change as I go from one unit cell to the next one. But what about if I have internal structure, if I have multiple state inside my unit cell, right? So that's what we're gonna try to visualize the geometry and the topology. For instance, here I'm just giving a example of graphene, right? So then essentially, you know, what I told you before, so now if you look at this, this is now my real space lattice. So, you know, then what I told you before, this e to the ikr, or basically the wave vector tells me that, okay, I go from one unit cell to the next one. How does the wave function change, the phase of the wave function change, you know, as I go from one unit cell to the next one? But this part doesn't really tell me how does the electron wave behave inside my unit cell. But, you know, if I, inside my unit cell, I only have one atom or one orbital, then there's nothing to talk about because that's the only degree of freedom, that's the only state I have. But here, even in graphene, which is a very simple lattice, you see that I already have two carbon atoms. So I have, you know, two states for my electron to occupy, right? So basically then we can appreciate that, you know, in my wave function, there's also a intra unit cell part. And then for the intra unit cell part, we can really just, you know, for instance, in this case, we talk about the A and B sublattice, then we can really just try to think about this as a qubit. Because, you know, this part basically tells me, you know, for a fixed K, I have an electron wave that propagates, you know, along certain direction with certain periodicity. But then within the unit cell, really it's like a qubit, basically means that the electron can try to choose whether it occupies the A sublattice or the B sublattice or any, you know, superposition state that is constructed by A and B, okay? So that's basically, you know, where things get more interesting, because now if we have a superposition, then we can define it or describe it on a Bloch sphere, as probably most of you guys know. Then, you know, basically, you know, we say, for instance, we can say the south north pole, it's The A sublattice, pure state. The south pole is the B sublattice, pure state. Then basically, every point on the equator is uniquely correspond to a unique superposition of A and B. Okay, so then basically my Bloch wave, which is an electron wave function, my electron wave function or my electron basically has to decide how it wants to occupy this, right? How it wants to form a superposition of A and B. Obviously, depending on the crystal, depending on interaction and all that. Okay, now so now basically for graphene. We know that A and B, the two carbon atoms are completely equivalent to each other, right? So there's nothing that can distinguish them. So therefore, we know that independent of momentum, for every electron wave function, it has to occupy a equal weight superposition of A and B, okay? So therefore, we know that if we go back to the Bloch sphere, we know that our wave function has to live on the equator, because the equator means equal weight superposition. If we talk about the northern hemisphere, that means that a superposition that has a larger probability of A than B, and if we go to the southern hemisphere, then vice versa. Okay? So then when you actually solve the type binding model, you could actually realize that actually, interestingly, basically what happened is that, let's say if I try to solve, we know that it has this, I didn't talk about it, but we know that, it has this Dirac-Kohn band structure for graphene. But then, let's say if I choose a constant energy, then basically my Fermi surface are circles around the K and K prime points. Now, if I just blow up, for the Fermi circle around the K point, then basically, I can try to figure out the wave function. Now basically my wave function is uniquely described by these unit vectors, right? Because they're uniquely described by a point on the Fermi surface, right? So then, in other words, they're unit vectors, okay? So now it turns out that if I solve the graphene wave function, what I can realize is that, as I go around this Fermi surface in K space, these vectors, first of all, I showed you, I argued from the symmetry point of view that they have to be live on the equators, so they're all in planes, okay? And then as I go around the Fermi surface, the direction of these vectors are also basically just rotating, okay? So then in other words, what I can say is that, for instance, if this guy, I don't think I wrote this down, so I need to write it. So if this guy is A plus I B, then this guy would be, let's say, A minus B. This guy would be, A plus B. I don't want to write the other one. It's too ugly, but, this is A minus IB. Yeah, okay. So then we can actually then take this and try to figure out what about the K prime point? What about the wave function in the K prime point by symmetry, right? For instance, we know that this graphene lattice has inversion symmetry. If I put the inversion center between the AB sublattice, the midpoint, and if I invert the entire space, then A goes to B, B goes to A, and the lattice becomes, is completely invariant, okay? We also know that the graphene has time reversal symmetry. If I invert the arrow of time, then nothing happens because graphene is nominally non-magnetic. And then if I look at how these orbitals translate in time reversal symmetry, if I stay at the A orbital, I imagine I have a charge sitting on A orbital. If I invert the arrow of time, the charge still stays at the A orbital. So A goes to A, B goes to B, okay? So then we can use either symmetry to figure out, because you know, if we start from this Fermi surface, let's say this point, then if I do either space inversion or time reversal, I go to this point on the opposite Fermi surface, right? The opposite K point. So then if I know the knowledge of the wave function here, then I can basically figure out the, let's say if we use space inversion, right? If I use space inversion, I basically connect, let's say, this point to this point. And I know that when I do space inversion, I invert A and B, right? So therefore, this is basically nothing but B, A goes to B, plus IA, okay? And B plus IA is the same as, A minus IB, okay? IB, okay? So then basically, yeah, so and on the other hand, if I go from this point, then I will be inverted to this point, and then this guy is, I just invert A and B, so it's B plus A, but B plus A is the same as A plus B. Okay, so I know that this point is pointing up, this point is pointing to the right, okay? So you can then basically use this rule to figure out all the wave functions, then you see this, okay? So then we, what I visualize is that, okay, so for the graphing wave function around the K and K prime values, basically they all look like some sort of vertices. In this case, as I go around the K space from the surface, my wave function as a pseudo spin or as a unit vector also basically rotates together. So as I go around, let's say counterclockwise for one turn, then my spin or my, not spin, not real spin, my wave function also rotates counterclockwise by one turn, okay? In this case, as I go around the Fermi surface by one turn counterclockwise, my wave function actually rotates clockwise in the opposite handedness, but also by 2 pi. So that's actually also just the so-called winding number, which you might heard of for graphing, okay? So, but this is really, you can visualize this without really calculating them, right? So then you should appreciate that basically I'm just showing you a particular Fermi surface, but obviously then you can do that for every point in your K space, right? So for every point in your K space, you have a electron wave function. The K, I choose any arbitrary K point, the K tells me how do I, my electron wave propagates as I go from one unit cell to the next one, but it doesn't tell me anything about how the electron occupies the space inside my unit cell. This little vector, on the other hand, tells me how do my electron occupies the states within my unit cell, right? For graphene, I have two states, A and B, and this tells me how the superposition is constructed. And basically then you can imagine, because you have different K, which is a parameter space, and then at every K you have a wave function which is a unit vector, then basically your entire valence band wave function is a vector field, right? Because at every K point you define a unit vector, right? So then you have a vector field, and once you have a vector field, then you can imagine you have vertices, you have monopoles, and that's where the topology comes from, or or basically the geometry, right? So that's graphene. How much time did I use? Okay, good. So then we can sort of think about what if, right, let's say I make A and B different, right? So I break the sublattice symmetry. Think about I go from graphene to hexagonal boron nitride. That would be an extreme case, right? So then in that case, basically we know from symmetry that now these two are different. So therefore, in principle, my state do not need to leave on the equator anymore, which is an equal wave superposition. Okay, so it can deviate from the equator. And specifically, you know, what will happen is essentially, you know, this is the gapless graphene where everything independent of energy, the wave function lives on the equator, but then this is the gapped graphene. What you can see is then basically, if I go to the tip of the band at the K point, then basically the electron really now goes to either the south pole or the north pole. Let's say if I say that and make it different in the case that an A orbital has a lower energy than B orbital, then my valence band at this tip point, at the K point, will entirely leave on the A orbital. And my conduction band will entirely leave on the B orbital. And as I go away from the tip point, then I start to, you know, start to recover more and more the gapless graph. In other words, I start to tilt back toward the equator. But then I will always remember these are unit vectors. So I'm only talking about the direction, okay? So here is pointing, out of plane, or basically along the vertical direction. But here is pointing in plane. So when I talk about out of plane, in plane, I mean the direction in the block sphere, not in K space, okay? So here is pointing out of plane, and here is recovering this in plane rotating structure, but it still has a small out of plane component. So then you can imagine it's like some sort of hedgehog kind of texture, okay? So that's basically what happens. Now basically, this is another maybe better visualization. You can see that, okay, so at the tip point, it's pointing to the A orbital. And then as I go back, it gradually recovers more and more of the in-plane texture with a small out-of-plane component. And then you can also, do the same thing for the K prime valley, okay? So now let's look at the symmetry again. So we say that space inversion symmetry, will connect K to K prime, will connect the opposite momentum, right? But it also flips A to B. But then this is A, this is pure A, this is also pure A, right? So therefore, when I have this kind of wave function, this has to break space inversion symmetry, because if I have space inversion symmetry, if this is A, then this must be B. But that's violated. So space inversion is violated, but time reversal symmetry is still intact. And you can, and indeed, right, because what we did is we make A and B different. So we broke the space inversion symmetry. So this symmetry also makes sense. And, then we can talk about, we can think about a gradual evolution, right? We can think about, let's say I go from graphene to hexagonal TMD to HBN, where, you make the A and B sublattice more and more different from each other, right? So then what happens is basically you are enlarging this symmetry breaking, which is proportional to the energy gap at the K and K prime points, okay? So then, in terms of the wave function, what you realize is that then, once you break this symmetry, you at the tip points, you always point upward for the A orbital, but when you have a weaker symmetry breaking, that means that as you go away from this K point, then gradually, quickly you recover back toward the equator. So in other words, you will map, if you take the entire valence band and map your entire valence band, every point on the K space to the block sphere, you obviously cover the North Pole because you have the pointing up. But then because you quickly recover almost back to the gapless case, you basically almost covers the entire North Hemisphere. You will never cover the entire North Hemisphere, but you can, you can go very close to this if the gap is small. By contrast, as you make the gap larger and larger, as you make A and B more and more different, you're essentially saying that even if I go far away, I still won't recover this equator case. So therefore, you are basically shrinking as you map the entire valence band, you're essentially shrinking toward the North Pole, okay? So if you imagine you make A and B absolutely really different, then this band becomes basically molecular orbitals. They become flat, and then you basically shrink back to the North Pole. And then for the conduction band, you shrink back to the South Pole, okay? So that would be why this is a trivial insulator, okay? Good. I should speed up a little bit. Okay, so then we can also using this to define the barrel curvature. So basically what we do is we can draw a loop in K space, okay? So in this case, you can see I go from 1 to 2, from 2 to 3, from 3 to 4, and from 4 back to 1. And then I ask, what is the amount of area? I map every point on this loop to the wave function, to the block sphere, and then I ask the amount of area I map on my block sphere. That is and divided by the area of my K space. And that's basically my barrel curvature. It's basically describing some sort of rotation of my wave function as a vector as I go a loop in K space, okay? So for instance, here, this is the gapless graphene. We know that they're basically just pointing in plane as this, you know, as this structure. So therefore, as I go from 1 to 2, nothing happens. I map onto the same point here. As I go from 2 to 3, I go from this point all the way to this point, because this is pointing to the right. And then I go from this, again, I stay here, and then I go back, I come back, right? So therefore, you know, my barrel curvature is 0, because I have not really mapped onto any finite area in my block sphere, okay? By contrast, if I gap the graphene, then what you realize is that basically 1, 2, 3, 4, right? So that map onto 1, 2, 3, 4, these 4 points, because now the vectors do not really sit on the equator. They have both, so then they are mapped onto this block, this finite area. So therefore we see that once we gap out the graphene, right? Once we break the AB sublattice symmetry, then my K valley can have a finite barrel curvature. And then the sign of the barrel curvature here is positive, because I have been going through my K space counterclockwise, and I also map out an area that is counterclockwise. So the sign is the same. So then if you do the similar analysis for the K prime valley, what you realize is that you also map onto a finite area, but then here you have clockwise, but then you map onto a counterclockwise, but you map onto a clockwise area. So therefore your barrel curvature is actually opposite for opposite values. Okay? So therefore we can also show from this point of view, we know that now I go back to the original equation, right? So we know that the Chern number is the integral of the barrel curvature. But then in this case, we know that the K and K prime valley has opposite barrel curvature. So therefore, you know, if I add up all the barrel curvature in K space, I get 0. So this is again a proof that I break AB sublattice, I just get a trivial insulator. Okay? Good. Okay. So now then we can almost naturally think about how do we make graphene topological, right? Because when we break the AB sublattice, we say that okay, we have both of these points, we gap it, and we have both of these T points pointing up. They both occupy only the A sublattice. But what if we break, we open up a gap, but we ask the pseudo spin or the wave function to occupy the A sublattice for the K valley, but B sublattice for the K prime valley, okay? So let's first check the symmetry, right? So now in this case, this is A, this is B, and they are both related by both time reversal and space inversion. But then time reversal requires, if I have time reversal symmetry, if this is A, then this must also be A. So therefore, in this case, I must break time reversal symmetry, but I could, in principle, preserve inversion symmetry. And that is basically also consistent with the fact that I'm going to have a Chern insulator or a quantum anomalous Hall insulator, and that's precisely the Haldane model, okay? So basically, what the key difference here is that now, at these 2 tip points, I occupy different sublattices, and as I go far away, then it's kind of similar. I gradually recover this equator situation, right? But then you realize that because now I cover both the North Pole here, but also the South Pole for the K prime, and I also cover the equator if I go, you know, sort of far away from these tip points, then essentially if I map all the points, all the wave function of my valence band onto the block sphere, I basically cover the entire block sphere. So that's actually the topological invariant, okay? So this is showing you the, we can also study the barrel curvature, right? So we, again, draw these loops. Now, if we map it onto the block sphere, 1, 2, 3, 4, then you realize that because now this vector here is pointing down, now you map onto this area. This is the key difference from the AB breaking, the inversion breaking case, right? So then you can show that now K and K prime in this kind of geometry has the same barrel curvature, has the same sign of barrel curvature, okay? So that's from the point of view of the barrel curvature. But it's essentially the same, okay? So basically, what we can realize is that basically we can visualize topology, essentially, maybe let me go back. Essentially, I can visualize topology by essentially if I take the entire, remember topology is a global response. So when I talk about global response, I can't just focus on at wave function at a particular k point. I have to look at the entirety of the band. That's also why I can't really talk about, yeah. So for instance, in this case, I map the wave function. I map this little vector of my wave function of the entire valence band onto the block sphere. And then the question I can ask is, what are the how many times do I cover the entire block sphere, right? So that number of times is a quantized number, and that is precisely the Chern number. Okay. So then basically we can compare these cases, right? So for instance, you have the graphene gapless to start with. You can break the inversion to make a trivial insulator. Okay, in that case, you're essentially covering sort of the only part of the northern hemisphere. By contrast, if you break it this way, then you cover the entire block sphere. So then this is a topological, you have a non-trivial Chern number. In this case, you have a trivial Chern number. But if we talk about geometry, if we talk about the curvature of the wave function, then we talk about local properties, okay? So here, although you have a trivial insulator, but locally, you can have large Barrel curvature. But then as you go from K to K prime, you have opposite Barrel curvature. So then when you add them up, you get trivial topological invariant. Okay? Good. Yeah. So so I talk about these how do we visualize this topological invariant by the wave function? But then what about how do I visualize the edge state, right? Because we know that when we have the Haldane model, we have a Chern number, so that means that this graphene now is gapped, and we'll also have a ballistic chiral edge state. So that, it turns out, can also be visualized from what I just talked about, okay? So for instance, now I think about the graphene and then the Haldane model, okay? So what I'm trying to say is now it's actually sufficient to think about basically the wave function of the electron at the tip points, the K and K prime, these six corners, okay? So for instance, we know that for this, this is the K prime, and it occupies, probably I use the opposite, it occupies, let's say, the A sublattice. So therefore, for this particular wave function, I know that it is an electron wave that is propagating to the right. So that's why I draw these arrows in real space that are propagating to the left, because momentum is negative. But also I know that this electron wave now is purely occupying only the red, the A sublattice. So therefore, I draw an electron wave that is propagating to the left, but also they are purely localized. You see that these arrows only go through the red atoms, okay? Now similarly, if I would try to visualize the wave function here, then that would be an electron wave that is going to the right, and they only occupy the B sublattice, okay? So therefore, I have six of them, right? So then I can draw these waves propagating to the right, propagating to the left, propagating to these directions, and they are only going through either the left, the blue, or the red atoms. And if you draw all of them, you see this. What you discover is that inside your graphene, you have this loop-like current, just like the Landau orbitals, right? But then on the edge, you're left with a single state that is ballistic, that go around the sample with a fixed chirality. And that's your chiral edge state, okay? So what I'm trying to say is that you can really use that to visualize both the topological invariant in the ball, but also the manifestation, which is the chiral edge state. Okay, good. I have 10 more minutes. So now we're ready to go to Dirac and Weil semi-metals. So basically, these are materials that, we talk about the Chern insulator, so these are gapped phase. Then the question to ask is, what if we have a gapless system? We have metals. Can we have topology? And it turns out that this was first sort of studied, not fully spelled out, by Murakami. So what he showed is that when you break inversion symmetry and you think about a topological phase transition from a trivial insulator to a topological insulator, you must go through an extended gapped phase. And I don't think he called it viosa metal, but he realized that this is some gapless semi-metal phase, okay? So basically, and start that. Okay. Is that it? Okay. Right. Should I start?
Yeah.
Okay, good. Yeah, so this is another schematic showing you that, you know, if you break, if you preserve both time reversal and inversion symmetry, you just get a single point as you vary some parameter, the boundaries touch and then they leave each other. But then if you break either of the two, then the band touch and then they form these vowel points and then there's an extended parameter space and then you go to the topological sign, okay? So it's a sort of, you can think about it as an intermediate phase as shown by Murakami. And then the topology was, now this one doesn't work, I have to stand here. So now the topology, maybe it works. Okay, yeah, was really then more extensively studied by Ashwin Vishwanath and also Anton and Leon Balance in two seminal theory papers. So essentially what we realized is that, you know, when you have these vowel submetals, you have in the bulk these gapless so-called vowel crossings or vowel fermions, and then on the surface you have these fermions, okay? So the vowel fermions come in pairs with opposite chirality, which have opposite turn number, okay? So how do I visualize this? Well, probably you saw this kind of Hamiltonian, K dot sigma kind of Hamiltonian, and basically this sigma here is precisely just the, you know, just the wave function, you know, just this unit vector on the Bloch sphere that I described to you, right? So because you have a K dot sigma kind of Hamiltonian, what you realize is that basically your the K, you start from the vowel point as the origin, right? So then basically you realize that your wave function really has the same direction, that this unit wave vector has the same direction as your K, right? So therefore, as you, let's say I choose this energy, then my Fermi surface is a sphere, then really my wave function is really pointing just outward, like a monopole pointing outward, but these are unit vectors, okay? Now, if I choose a larger one, then nothing changes. I still have this kind of wave function, right? So in other words, if I would try to map these wave functions onto my Bloch sphere, then really it's a one-to-one mapping. The north pole of my K space from the surface is essentially the north pole of my Bloch sphere, okay? So then for the negative charge vowel point, it basically is minus k dot sigma. So then what you realize is that then everything is pointing inward. So then if you were trying to map it out, then your north pole of your k space is actually the south pole of your block sphere. And then that gives you a Chern number of minus one. Okay? So then you can also see that because this is one-to-one mapping, and we just talk about that the Berry curvature is the area that you map on the block sphere divided by the area, you know, when you choose a loop in the K space. Now, if you compare these two different energies, they have exactly the same mapping, but this one obviously has a smaller K and therefore a smaller area in K space. So therefore, the Berry curvature will also form a monopole, but then the magnitude of the Berry curvature will become larger and larger as they go closer and closer to the vowel point. If I really go to the vowel point, then the area of the K space is approaching zero, so therefore my Berry curvature diverges. Okay, so the Berry curvature will basically decay as 1/k², you know, as we go away from the vowel point. It has a monopole configuration, and this one has an anti-monopole configuration. Okay, good. So then you can visualize, and then this is what these theorists figure out the topology of the vowel point. Because then you can basically choose a k-space sphere, just like what I told you, that enclose the vowel point, right? Then you can basically, this is like a two-dimensional Brillouin zone or two-dimensional k-space that is closed. Then you can talk about the integral of the Berry curvature or the Chern number on this sphere. Then we know that because of this monopole geometry, the Chern number is plus one for this guy and minus one for this guy. And that's basically what we talk about, the topological charge, right? And then we can also visualize the Fermi arc, right? Because instead of choosing a sphere, we can also choose a cylinder. The cylinder will be truncated on the edge of my 3D Brillouin zone, basically on the surface, and will leave a small circle on the surface, right? So now, basically, I can also ask, now this is, the cylinder is also closed, right? So therefore, I can also ask, what is the Chern number of the band on this two-dimensional cylinder? And because I enclose the vowel point because of the monopole of the Berry curvature, this one will also give me a Chern number of plus one, right? Because it's plus one, and now I have an edge, which is this little circle, I know that there must be an edge state that is a chiral edge state, just like the quantum anomalous Hall, okay? So therefore, I can draw any cylinder, but as long as my cylinder, you know, encloses only the red one, then I always have a positive Chern number. That means that for any radius away from this point, I will always have this green state. And this green state will only terminate once I draw the cylinder large enough that it encloses both of the vowel points. That's why on the surface, I have an arc that goes from one vowel point to the next one. So that's the Fermi arc, okay? And then you can also do that for the opposite one, then you get the opposite Fermi arc. Okay, good. So let me spend 5 minutes to talk about the experiment, and we'll talk more in the next lecture. So this is the theoretical discovery which was done in 2011, and this is quite interesting because people have already been very excited about topological insulator. Now there's a chance to realize topology in metals, but then, you know, and then there's many interesting phenomena. I talk about these two, but then there's also the, you know, transport, like chiral anomaly that Anton talk about, but then Fermi arc, quantum oscillation, and other interesting phenomena. So then, you know, and we know that, you know, theoretically, we have to break either inversion or time reversal, as I showed you from Lakami's theory paper. So that corresponds to either non-central symmetric or some sort of magnetically ordered material. Okay, but you know, since the initial proposal, you know, people have been searching that for a while, for a few years, basically without any luck. Well, there are very interesting proposals like the perchlor iridate and these multi-layers of topological insulators, but they either are very difficult to grow or people have grown them, but then, you know, this turns out to be very complicated and in some cases strongly correlated. So we, at some point, we were motivated to basically search for them, you know, basically for to search for candidates by ourselves. So this was work I did when I was a student at Princeton University, a PhD student. So then we thought, okay, so we want this kind of band structure that are semi-metal in 3D. So if we try to zoom out, this is nothing, but basically we have two bands that cross each other. So then basically, you know, what we need, and I should say that at that point, at that time, you know, now there are like this topological database, and people have basically developed this very fancy algorithm, like symmetry indicator, that allows you to compute the topology of all the, you know, materials that are recorded in the inorganic crystallographic database. At that point in 2014, there were no such thing. And then for every material, it takes a lot of time for people to calculate. So basically what we wanted to do along with our DFT collaborator is we want to go through the inorganic crystallographic database, but we want to use some sort of chemical intuition to tell them, look, maybe these few materials are quite promising, you can calculate them. So that's what we want to achieve, okay? So then, you know, if we think about this, these are essentially semi-metals, right? So then essentially we have, in all these three cases, you have charge balanced the system, but then they, in this case, they have a gap. In this case, they have no gap, they have a crossing, okay? So then, I don't know what happened. Yeah, so I think I can go until here. Yeah, so basically, then we were thinking about how to search for this charge balanced system. So, you know, let's say, you know, if I think about, you know, sodium chloride, right, if I really go to the molecular limit, then I know that, you know, basically the HOMO and LUMO, the two lowest energy orbitals, are the cation and the anion, and then this energy gap here describes basically the ionic bonding strength, you know, the amount of energy I release, or if I really excite the electron from here to here, the amount of energy that will cost for the sodium to give us, for the sodium to get back the electron that they donate, which lowers the energy, right? So then the second energy scale here is the essentially the hopping amplitude, which describes the wave function overlap between nearby orbitals, okay? So in this case, we know that sodium chloride really likes to form an ionic bond, so this energy splitting is really large, so even if I extend this level into a band, I still have an insulator. We know that this is a salt, this is an insulator. So this also gives us a way to basically think about how do we search for semi-metals. Basically, we just want, you know, hypothetically AB kind of chemical structure, but then the electronegativity difference between these two elements has to be much, much smaller than sodium chloride, so that this energy splitting is much, much smaller, so that when I extend them into bands, they cross each other. So that's what we were searching for. And obviously we need to search for non-central symmetric groups. So there are, you know, in total these many, in these many, you can label them by the space group number. Right, so then you can go to the inorganic crystallographic database and just put in the space group number and look at all the chemical formulas that chemists have synthesized for a particular non-central symmetric space group and use your chemical intuition to figure out what are the likely semi-metals, and then ask our collaborator to basically calculate. So this is basically led to, you know, this prediction of this tantalum arsenide. You can think about this is 3-, this is 3+, but then obviously, you know, this electronegativity difference is much smaller than sodium chloride. So then when we calculate, we found these very nice crossing points, and then there's also concurrent work at the same time from the IOP group for this proposal. Okay, so this really led to the experimental discovery, which I think I should talk about in the next lecture. So basically, yeah, so then we were doing ARPES, and then also concurrent with the IOP group, we found these Fermi arcs and vowel point in these tantalum arsenide class of materials. So I'll stop here, and we'll continue in the next one, yeah? Thank you.
Hey, are there any questions?
So essentially these vowel points are crossings between singly degenerate bands. If you have both time reversal and space inversion symmetry. Okay, I did not explain that well. then the bands are always doubly degenerate. So then you can't have crossing between singly degenerate bands. And then, you know, what we were thinking at the time was, you know, there was originally already like proposal about perchloride uridate, which, you know, supposed to be a, could be a bioset metal based on the magnetic order. But then this magnetic order at that time, we thought it was always complicated. So then we were thinking, and also, you know, it's not really like you have a magnetic database that records all the materials and their specific magnetic order and spin orientation. It, that one, even until now, it doesn't really exist. But there are very comprehensive crystallographic database. So then we can very easily just go there and look at all the non-central symmetric crystals. And that was at the time our logic for searching for this in the non-central symmetric structures. But then obviously now people found this Kagome and other materials that are magnetic and that have vowel points, but that's after this. So at that time we were just trying to find the first one. And we thought that's the most viable search scheme. Yeah.
Anton, Peter.
Is there any way to visualize the Fermi arc in the same way you visualize tidal surface states in the Kagome model?
Yeah. So, for instance, you know, this is the surface state of tantalum arsenide, and you see that there are like these two.
What I meant is, you know, you have this nice picture of how H states are like.
Yeah, yeah. I know. But you see, these are the two arcs, right? So what I can do is I can basically draw a circle and go around only enclosing one of the terminating points, and then basically plot the dispersion along this circle. Then you see that you have two chiral edge states. And that's related to the fact that here this vowel point has a charge of two. I mean, actually, the projection of the vowel point has charge of two. Yeah. So that's turn number two. Yeah.
We have time for one more quick question. There is one. Also, I've been told if we run out of time for questions, or if you think of a question later, there's a Google Doc that you can go to, and I guess the presenters can answer your questions at their leisure. All right, no more questions. Let's thank our speaker one more time.